Hello. Hi. Didn't you had your lunch properly? I cannot hear you properly. Hello. So I am Swastik Parikh and I work as a senior UI UX developer at QED42. I have with me today Saket Kumar, that is UI UX lead at QED42 only. And our session will be Art of Debugging Using Chrome DevTools. So before I start on, is my voice is clear at the back? Can you hear me, guys? Okay. So today we'll be focusing on front-end rendering performance and what all criteria and variables and what all parameters that we should be focusing on to increase the performance and know the crates and pits where your rendering gets a jaggery experience and where you need to focus and, you know, just to make your site more performant. Next slide, please. So you know about the speakers. I want to know about my audience also. So who all are front-end developers here? Raise your hand. Who all are project managers? Nobody. Whoa. And who all are back-end developers? I'm sorry, guys, that presentation won't be so much informative for you guys because you'll be focusing mainly on front-end rendering, but you can still sit and watch the session.
But yeah, you can use this information and tell your front-end developer that this is not our mistake, it's yours.
Nice. So we'll be focusing on front-end developers and the project owners and the project developers and the project managers that wants a good user experience. So the product that we'll be working on, they want a good, they want to deliver a good product that has a good user experience. So talking about a successful application, what is a successful application? Anybody want to answer this? What do you think a successful application is? What makes an application successful? Anybody? Raise your hand, stand up.
User friendly.
What else?
Performance.
Secure. Yes.
Then you need a bit best user experience. It should give. Should not feel anything like jaggery or not.
But what about the, so you're thinking about through the developer perspective, you're not thinking about a project manager perspective because you don't have any project managers over here. So if you want to deliver a successful application, there is a ROI associated with every application. So you invest some amount and you expect a return from it. So if you want to deliver a successful application, what you'll do is you'll create your application and make it performant using a good hardware, let's say 2GB RAM you're using, and some high RAM at the back end, good servers and caching, that all you're using. But what about the ROI? So if you have invested such a big amount on your hardware and you don't have a proper ROI from it, then what happens? So it won't be called a successful application for the project manager because the ROI is not there. But if in the less ROI, when there's less hardware and you know you have to work with 500 MB RAM, the application cannot be performant enough, right? So what we have to focus here is the sweet spot where the application is performant enough and it should give a proper ROI so that it's you know, successful for both project managers and developers. So as I told you, we'll be focusing on the front-end performance only here. So I want you to know about the rendering process before we actually hop onto the variables and parameters that are responsible for performance. So whenever you request a resource from the server, what all processes happens? What all processes the browser goes through to fetch them?
So basically, we are talking about more of a browser rendering process here. So how browser, once the response is there, then how browsers paint it over here and what you see as in your applications. So this is what we are talking about here.
So after these slides, we'll have a demo session, and due to scarcity of the time, we will be moving very fast on the slides and focusing more on demos. The rendering process. So if anyone of you have ever opened DevTools and opened the network tab, you must have seen a layout like this. So whenever you hit a URL, all the resources that get loaded on the page, shows up in the network tab. On the right hand side, you can see there's a blue and orange and green box in which there's a timeline type structure. That is the time that a resource actually took to get rendered on the page. By rendering, there are two phases. First, the request response that happens between server and client, and the second of all, the browser rendering, how browser renders it. So whenever you request a URL, whenever you request a resource from a server, this all process happens at the back end, the browser. So whenever you hit a URL on the browser, it actually redirects you to the app cache, where it search for a cached copy of the resource that you're looking for. If it finds it in the app cache, then it hops onto the request response phase, where it requests the resource from the app cache, and app cache responds with the resource. And it's pretty clear, if you don't find it in app cache, then you have to do a DNS lookup, then create a TCP connection to the server, and then do request and response. So modern browser, what they do is they expose all those variables and all those breakpoints where you can actually find out how much time did each phase took. So as you can see over at the top, you're seeing start time, redirect start. I'm not sure whether you'll be visible at the back, but I can read it for you. So it's start time, redirect end time, and like this, every phase is a start time and an end time. And all modern browsers actually expose these data. So you can actually see those data into console and figure out which phase is taking what time and where you need to focus on. Right? So moving on. Now we have the HTML and CSS on all the resources in our browser, but we still have to render them. So how browser actually renders all the data on the website, how it actually populates each pixel with the proper color that it should be. So the process through which the browser goes and renders the content on the screen, that's called a pixel pipeline. So how it actually happens? So when the HTML DOM gets built and the CSS gets fetched, when the DOM event fire, when the DOM is complete, there are some JavaScript that actually alters the DOM, or there are some CSS styles that we actually apply, or some add some CSS class that actually applies some CSS properties to the element. So what happens initially, after the DOM event gets completed, all the alteration has been acknowledged by the browser, so that a new HTML DOM has been created. After the DOM gets created and the CSS property has been fetched, all the style calculation has been done by the browser. Now, style calculation, we mean that all the elements, we actually override some styles. We actually have selectors, you know, where multiple styles and multiple selectors are getting applied to an element. So browser actually do some parsing and calculates whole styles that need to be applied on the element. After the style calculations, layouting happens. So just a previous slide. Layouting, in layouting, what happens is the CSS styling and the HTML DOM gets combined and a render tree is created, in which there's style element to style mapping. And it creates different frames and it actually finds out which element will take what dimensions and where it should be, you know, located on the screen. So this process is called layouting. The next process that happens is paint, in which all these layers are superimposed onto each other and a single layer has been created. And after that paint process happens, in which, you know, coloring and box shadows, all the properties that are related to aesthetics of the website, that's get, you know, rendered. After paint and layouting, composition happens, in which a final layout is rendered on the screen. By compositing, you can assume compositing as rendering different layers at the different level of the browser. So you must have seen, if you give a z-index mode to an element, it will be superimposed on the element that has less z-index. So this part is done in the composting phase. Next slide. Taking a deep dive into the process, as you can see, HTML passed into HTML DOM, CSS styles get passed into style rules, and these both DOM gets attached and a render trees get created, in which layouting, painting, and then display of the contents is done. And this is a typical flow of a WebKit engine. So when Firefox uses Geeko engine, and other browsers like Safari and Chrome uses WebKit engine. So this is a flow of WebKit engine. Geeko and WebKit has the same application, but they have different terminologies associated with it. So in Geeko, you'll find painting as layouting as a reflow reflow text, and you painting is repainting. It's more or less same. So after you know the DOM gets created and user is interacting with the website, there are some events that get fired up, like clicking, mouse over, or scrolling. So these events actually repaint the whole website and sometimes actually trigger layouting and recomposting also. So if there's some JavaScript that actually changing some property, or there's some CSS class that actually changing some styling, this process gets you know started and initiated again. So there are some CSS properties that triggers layout, that triggers paint, and that triggers composting. You can find those properties on css3triggers.com and you know figure out which property triggers which part of the pixel pipeline. So if you change the property that is related to layout, it has to go through the to hold the process. All the JavaScript calculation will be done then after styling, layouting, painting, and composting. And if you are changing a property that is related to paint, the layouting process has been skipped. And in case of composting, layouting and painting, both processes get skipped. So you have to take care whenever you are actually applying some new style, make sure that CSS and the JavaScript that you're applying should change least, you know, least priority component of the pixel pipeline. So it will be very best if you're changing something that related to composting so that your new frame, the new refresh frame that happens on the browser comes very fast, because it's actually skipped two processes and it will take less time. So that should you take in mind. Next slide. So we're talking about performance. And when you're talking about performance, we talk about speed. So do you guys think there is a specific time frame that defines your website to be a slow or fast, or any task to be slow or fast? Do we, who says yes? Who says no? And everybody else is sleeping. Wow. So this is a bit contextual thing. You cannot say whether it's slow or fast on a fixed timeline, because it actually depends upon the task that you are doing. So for example, if you are on a mobile device and you are actually triggering the click event, it will take some time to respond, because the click event gets registered on your hardware, then hardware actually triggers to the OS of the mobile. The OS of the mobile actually forward it to the browser, and the browser actually acknowledges it. This takes time. So in this process, it will take around 100 milliseconds or 60 milliseconds or 70 milliseconds. That is the least time that it will take. But in case of animation, that CSS animation that's happening, every screen refresh, if it will take around 50 or 60 milliseconds, the frame per second will be around 18 and 20 frames, and it will give you a jaggery experience. So in that case, 60 milliseconds is very slow. So you see, 50 milliseconds or 60 milliseconds or any fixed timeline is not the parameter that you should think about that makes your site fast or slow. It's about the task, you see. So HCL did a small research, and they figured out that if a user spends some time on your website, and if it requests an event, so if it triggers an event or requests something from the browser, and if the browser responds in a specific time frames, what a user human mind thinks about it? Excuse me. So if the response gets to the user in less than 100 milliseconds, then the user will think it's really fast, you know. And if the response is around 1 millisecond, then the user mind will get, it will get out of context and will start seeing other things. And if it takes more than 10 seconds, then what will user do? Will open a new tab and do Facebook, right? So what you should target about is to respond and load the content as fast as you can at the front end. So for this, to set the guidelines, the developers all around the world came out with this RAIL model. So so the RAIL model actually breaks down the user activity into key actions like drag, drop, tap, click, and it defines the standards of performance goals for these user actions. What should be the performance criteria for it? and it defines a basic layout where all developers and designers can come to a reliable platform where they can think about the area which has the maximum impact of work. So Rail model, as you can see, it's break down into four parts: response, animation, idle, and load. So what does response says? So whenever user do some activity, if it clicks on the browser or if it clicks on this mobile screen, there's a response that the website gives, right? And that response should be as fast as it could be. And the Rail model defines that the response should be under 100 milliseconds. So whenever you initiate a click event or whether you do some user activity on the website, suppose a mouse over or whatever, or you know, if you click on something and some part of the DOM gets deleted, that all action should be responded under 100 milliseconds. If you talk about animation, so here animation, we are talking about the CSS and JavaScript animation that happens on the website. So these animations should happen. So I want to highlight here the human eye perception. So it's like that human eye cannot figure out the difference if the frame rate is more than 60 FPS or 70 FPS, because we cannot figure out the difference if in any moving thing, if it's moving faster than 60 milliseconds per frame. So what Rail model says that your animation should be around 60 FPS. The refresh rate should be around 60 FPS. So if you're doing some animation in the CSS styling that gets updated, taking time more than 20 milliseconds or 25 milliseconds, then it'll come around 40 FPS, and then you'll feel a jaggery experience, and you'll probably think that website is not that you know, smooth and responsive enough. Idle state, so if all background processes that are, you know, very high time taking processes and that need a proper resource, all should be prioritized when the website is idle. So when user is not doing anything with the website, so that, you know, you actually preload the data, or you know, lazy load the data. And all the background activity should be breaking in the chunks of 50 milliseconds, because you want to prioritize other events. Like suppose you are having a background activity, and in that background activity suddenly user clicks on something and it expect a response in, you know, 100 milliseconds, then actually the process thread should stop after 50 milliseconds and give the priority to the response event. You get the idea? So, and the last component is load. Load is pretty clear. It says that, you know, you should respond, you should deliver the content in 100 milliseconds. So first of all, whenever you click on a browser, whenever you click on any link, when the website gets loaded on the browser for the first time, all the content should get loaded in 100 milliseconds. So you should load the data in 100 milliseconds. That are the four components and four pillars of, you know, Rail model. Next slide. Yeah. So it depends upon the OS and the hardware. So here we are not actually discussing about the hardware and the back-end thing. We are actually focusing about the front-end thing.
So basically, our target is our script, our code should not take more than 100 milliseconds to respond to a particular user event. Similarly, it should not take 100 milliseconds to more than 1000 milliseconds to load that data. Yeah, JavaScript. So basically, we are talking about once the server has responded, that respond event has been done.
So I think your question is like, if I made a very good and responsive website, but it's breaking an i8 and i7. Obviously, it will break because you are actually working with by loading the content, I meant the rendering process. We are actually focusing about the rendering process, the time it takes till the HTML DOM and CSS, after the CSS DOM and HTML DOM gets ready and before the site gets painted on the browser. That should take 100 milliseconds.
But I don't think when you say like that, there's any mobile device that actually, that doesn't mean less than 100 milliseconds.
Yeah, so the devices won't respond, but I'll show you how we can keep ourselves. The browser will respond. I'll show you the thing and how.
So I think you should wait for the demos to come in, because
basically it's our target. We should do this in this much time, and it all depends on your content. So if you are trying to load thousands of frames in a on a single site, on a single web page, it won't. But if it's a, it's about a single image, it will. And if it keep our code structured and in properly keeping it and prioritizing what task is important for the user, it will. It will. In fact, it might not be the be the into that cap of 100 milliseconds, but it won't, again, it won't be, user would know, yeah, ki he's on a very slow device, he will,
So I think you are actually getting confused here. So the loading time is actually related to the rendering process, and after the DOM gets ready and it actually paints the website, then the time frame should be of 100 milliseconds. We're not talking about device specific. This is the ideal case that should happen. It will never happen around 100 milliseconds. But this is the ideal case that we should look forward to. Okay. So since we have seen that all four components of yes.
Just at this point, like the perception of the user that something other.
You want to
see? No.
I would say it's a perception of the user to think that something is happening. It necessarily may not have anything being loaded, because if you see Facebook, if you open the app, it actually shows some placeholders, right? And you feel like something is happening. It takes a lot more time, but the user does not get frustrated that it's a blank page.
Right, you exactly know? What you mean.
So you must have heard about progressive rendering, like Angular does, right? It does not load the whole website in a single go. It actually renders some components. So we are loading, the loading concept here actually means about this. So you first, the first load that happens, the first painting that happens should happen under 100 milliseconds. So prioritizing all those things, all those four models are equally important, but they are actually specific about the kind of website that we are dealing with. Some websites are content website, which actually focused about the content they have. So in that case, load and idle time would have more priority. We have to more focus on load and idle time. But for mobile native application, if you are looking for a website that should open in mobile or some Ionic website, then we should focus on user activities like response and animation. So it depends upon context to context. For some websites, the idle time and the load component should have a high priority, and for some websites, the response and animation should be
the high priority.
So basically,
it's the user perspective again here. So if we are on a news site where the content is more important, so the components here, RAIL, the response animation, that does not mean that much for the user, but for him. That loading of content, the content is most important part for him. Similarly, when he's on a application or a mobile device, a mobile app, and for him, there the response from that application is more important for him than the content which he's looking. Though the content is very important as well, but yeah, if he sees, you might have. I guess face this issue, like for a particular application, you click on a button, and if you don't see any response, you try to click twice or thrice, assuming that you might not have clicked it properly. So this is where that user perspective comes in.
Yeah. So you should actually respond. No, the R model of Rail, you should actually respond in 100 milliseconds so that user actually thinks about that browser, actually acknowledge your user activity, that whatever you've done on it.
And again, coming to this event, in case of event, not all tasks or can be categorized into individually response and then animation load, but all the user events are some sort of composite actions. Like if you click on something, user expects a response. Like here in this GIF, on clicking of menu, there is the response of that click, and then animation is happening, and then the load of that menu content is there. So basically, it's a composite action comprising of all the three steps. So
not
now,
all, yeah.
So now the basic question here is, what is more important? If we follow rail, and so what should be our target to achieve that my user should not have any jaggery experience or and so from I think user is doing something, he's clicking on a clicking something, and he's expecting, his first expectation would be that he should get some response, a response to his event, so his click. So first target is to give some response and animate, the animation happens after that, and then that load content is loaded. So first priority is the response to that user. So how we target, how we structure this event or this our JavaScript is, first we will give the response to this user, and that will be capped into 100 milliseconds. We'll target it into 100 milliseconds, and then we'll load the content over there. Okay.
I want to highlight one more example over here. So suppose you have a website, okay, on which there's a link, and when you click on the link, so there's some AJAX request that goes to the server and actually gets some data, and it renders on the web page. So there are two phases that through which you can implement it. So whenever you click on that link, the AJAX request gets initiated, and the browser waits for the AJAX request to complete. After 5 or 10 seconds, the AJAX request gets complete, and then it actually renders it on the website. Or the other method should be, whenever the user click on the link, as soon as it clicks on the link, a pop-up model with empty data gets pop in, and there's a loader text that comes in, and after 5 milliseconds, when the AJAX request gets completed, it actually loads the data on the website. So what do you guys think? Is the first phase will be, more performant or more fast, or the second phase? Obviously the second phase, because actually user got the idea that website has actually responded in 100 milliseconds. So that's the whole idea of this response animation idle and load. So as I told you that we'll be moving fast on slides and focusing more on demos, so we'll be starting with demos.
Yeah. For example, if I take this, so window is quite small for me. So this DrupalCon HSI. So in this demo, I'll be showing you how that when we talked in our slide that once we load. Is it okay if I increase the resolution?
Just because the whole console is not getting loaded on the
screen, we have to reduce the resolution.
Is it okay? Is it visible at the back? No? No. I'll have to revert it.
Just zoom the content that you're showing, because we need to show the whole.
Okay, I'll try to do it here itself. So on a particular website, when we load, when we do a reload going on network tab. So basically this is for what all events happen when we do a reload. So you see all the resources are downloaded, and then in Chrome, we have this blue line and then red line. So this blue line says that this is the first first meaningful frame of the that website where the user can start interacting to its to this website. So now from this, so this is the network tab, and from here what we can get is, if we try to reduce this gap of from the start of the load to the first meaningful frame, if we try to if we decrease this timeline, my user would get a faster interactive session, means he can start to interact with the site more quickly. So here basically the first meaningful frame appeared at 5:43, so this DOM content loaded 5:43 seconds. So if so here this is for the backend users, if they can structure their backend, and if we reduce this timeline, our user can get a better experience. So in just 2-3 hours before, I was in that big pipe BOF by Piyush, and we actually checked that this DOM content loaded section, it increases by so this timeline decreases by around 2 to 3 seconds if we use Big Pipe, and our user can start to interact to the website 2 seconds before, even for a single block content. So I think, that we need to have a Big Pipe implemented, that I don't have right now. So if we also, our browsers are so open nowadays that they exposes all the information for the resources they're getting. So if we go to there is this API, and if we try to get this information, get entries by type, and if you get enter resource, it will give you all the resources which have been downloaded downloaded over this site. And if you open, so basically for each resource we give that timeline when that redirection starts, then DNS lookup, then TCP connection, and then response start and response end happens. So here is the timeline for this the resource which I can. So the resource which we are talking about is here, some of the CSS file basically, and so we can get the time to download, to basically render a resource over here. If we subtract this respond end with the start time, we get that exact amount of time which it took to basically paint it over the browser. So now what we can do is, if there is a resource from backend which is taking too much of time, we can basically get the information that from here, and then basically that if that resource is stopping that first meaningful content, first meaningful frame to appear, so we can get that information from here, and then we can print it. So for for example, there were too many resources on that page, so it might be confused. Here, just one image. This is the single resource which we are downloading here, and then I've written a JavaScript to basically get the time, how much time it took to paint it over the browser. So when we run, so basically this was the time it took to fetch this resource and paint it over the browser. So this is basically this is how we can get the information of a particular resource. Now, how many of you have used timeline in the Chrome? This use this Chrome timeline. Clear this. Nobody? Yeah. So basically, this tab gives you all complete information of what happens from the time it starts loading to the time, or it gives you all information about all the JavaScript, all the CSS, all the painting, all compositing, all layout recalculation, everything happening here. So basically, if we utilize this tab properly, we can get all information, and if some problem is happening, I'll try to debug and show you how we can basically get that information and select what to do and what not to do over this. First, that Swastik talked about that JavaScript layout, paint, and composite. So I'll demo that first. So this is a most simple example I could do. Basically, I'll be showing you. So this site, what it does is there's this click event, and then some CSS changes is there. So I'll show it. Basically, this. I'll start the recording and then try to click those. Stop the recording. So this is where I can it even takes the screenshots, and we can let's zoom in here and.
This green line shows where the click event happened and how much time the click event took to respond and how much time it took to lay out and, you know, paint and render, and how much the time the pixel pipeline took. You can see it over there.
This click event happened here, and then these yellow bar shows so where exactly what all functions have been. So these yellow means where the JavaScript run. Then this violet line, if we zoom in more. So these yellows are for JavaScript. These violet are for recalculate. You can see the recalculation of styles. This is being marked here. And then composite layers. So these are the activities which the browser did, and in these timelines it took. So for that click event, it took around, you can see, 2.3 milliseconds, and then to call that function, it called a function. So basically, you can drill down into it and get more information about your JavaScript and what CSS and it CSS it's triggering. And if you find any issue, you can basically see.
So it has the same color code that you've seen in Pixel Pipeline, where the JavaScript was shown by yellow color, the style and layouting shown by the violet color, and the painting and compositing was shown in the green color. It holds the same color code.
And if you select a particular function, it gives you the information about it and where from it was triggered. So you can even click here and then you can see. So basically, that click event is from this JavaScript, and it's doing is changing the width of the body, and on the second click, it again changing. So so basically, I'm just changing the width of the body. Now, and on timeline, this function triggers this calculation, and so this recalculation of style happened, and it took around 0.9 milliseconds. Then, after that, this the layer tree was updated. And it took around 0.06 milliseconds, and then layer composition, which took around 0.13 milliseconds, and lastly the paint activity happened, and we had this so with one click, first click, we had this information, so this last frame. And when we check in paint profiler, this is how it happened. So basically, painting. So basically, checking the paint profiler after composition of layers. How this now painting is being done. So there's. It will start with this save activity, then that a clip rectangle came in, then again the second clip rectangle came in, and then the first frame, first rectangle was painted of the color, and then the second. So this is how you can check basically step by step which all functions of the browser have been called to show the paint profiler, and how this paint happening. Now, so this you see the complete process of a particular user event where JS was called, and then some DOM manipulation happened, then CSS, and then layout is done. So basically this demo is to understand what all processes happen when we. So if you saw that slide where that WebKit chart was that how an HTML parses that DOM. Do we have chalks? Yeah. So for example, if we have
please let us know if it's not visible at the back. We can increase the font size.
No.
I think we have to use the screen.
Okay.
Or we can hop into the next example.
I'll let the or we can use this. So basically, this is the markup, and then what HTML parser does is it parses all the tags in this markup and creates a DOM tree. So DOM tree is DOM tree is something like this is body, then a div, then another div where we have one h1 and one here p tag, here we have one more p tag, here we have span.
It's a simple tree where there is a parent to children relationship.
All I think this is visible. This tree structure is at least visible to you. So basically, this is the, we can say, this is the DOM tree. And each tag has its own node. This is this comes into DOM. Similarly, there is CSS parser. CSS parser converts all of the CSS which was loaded, which was downloaded, and it creates a CSS DOM. So if you have so this symbolizes similar body CSS, so all the styles for body, then for that div, then for this div, and so you get me. This is the tags, and these are the styles for each tags. So basically, this is the DOM tree, and this is the CSS DOM tree, and DOM and CSS DOM. Now, so this is the parsing phase. Now, after parsing, what happens is these both the trees, both the DOM tree and CSS DOM tree, they are merged, and a rendered tree. So if we add this, we get a render tree. Okay, and this it is similar to it's also a tree structure with so that render tree would be body plus CSS, body CSS, div plus div, this div CSS and all. So basically that render tree is built, and now with, so suppose if this is our render tree now with all the tags and then CSS as well. Now for each node their render tree has been made. Now for each layer, for each node, layers are created. So basically this would be body, and then layer for this div. Basically, all the layer, all the DOM elements which has some styles and everything, it is painted over. It is basically marked over the DOM, like this divs, and then all the. So basically, these are the separate layers now. Now after, and this phase is. So basically, this phase is layering, and then all of these layers are composited and painted in a single layer, not a single layer, or basically renderable layer. And for all these things, so when we saw this in the timeline, all these functions. So basically. After the layers are created, each layers are pulled into a single, and it is painted in these steps. You could see here. A better example I could show you is of a paint. Could be, yeah. So this is a very, very long right, and then if we go to timeline. So you see, so for each, I think this is a older thing. But yeah, I can. I think you can see that each of the items are being painted. And these are the functions. These are the functions being called for each: clip rectangle, draw rectangle, and all. Yeah. So this is how our browser functions. You can see this painting happening. So since this is a very long frame, very big frame, you can see it from here. So it would take much time, very much time. Okay. Now, so I think everybody is clear with how that our browser paints and does stuff. I'll show you one more demo where we can basically debug our JavaScript and get to know. So this example is about sorting of this table, okay? And what I'm doing is, for one, I'm using a bubble sort custom JavaScript function, and the other, I'm using browser sort default sort function. So, and we'll see in the timeline. We start the record and we sort it by name, and then we sort it by number. We treat both. You see, this is the timeline recording. And you can clearly figure out which click event took more time from the timeline. So obviously the first click took more time than the second one. And you can easily. So this is in my timeline. If you see this script for the one sort one function, we called a bubble sort function, and this is what this timeline shows. For the first click, the JavaScript run, it took around, if you see, 470 milliseconds. If you can see it from here. Okay. It took around 470 milliseconds, and for the second one, the default function, the sort function, it took around, the one sort two, it took around 77.7 milliseconds. So you can see the difference of the. So basically, the both are of sorting, and so this is how we can debug and get which function and is taking more time in our timeline, and we can basically, if you check the layout timing, the time which it took to. After the JavaScript, the time it took to paint this was same, and the time it took to for both those functions it was same, but for the function it took time. So we now know the problem is in our JavaScript. We need to work on the function which is taking more time. Not the issue is not with the CSS and all. So I'll show you one more. Basically here I've written a small script for So I'm, what I'm doing is I'm inspecting which I'm targeting all the titles box, the, all the titles from these three selectors. So basically, all the three selectors, if you see, are targeting the same elements. But I've written this script to basically get the time, how much time it took for that selector to select that element and compile it. So if and when I click this button, that JavaScript runs, and see if you can see the time taken for each of these. So now how many of you are aware of BEM modifier or block element modifier writing CSS classes? So see, the second one is in BEM model, if you see. And these are, we are targeting direct classes, not using any of the pseudo classes here for this and even for this. Here we are using pseudo classes. So if you go to, there is this CSS triggers, it even mentions that for pseudo classes that the browser has to go to that element, the parent element, to compile it. So and so if we are targeting box nth last child, so that to compile this CSS class, basically browser has to go to the parent box class, and then the nth child, it has to get that nth child to give this. So basically the time taken for this is this much. But if we give a single class for each of the direct classes, and like we did in the second selector, where we target the direct, not the pseudo classes, so it took less time. So even through this, we can get to know that these small things makes difference in our CSS and the whole of the painting and rendering process. So I think if we implement these small changes, we can actually make our front end more faster. So I think that should be okay.
So we are done with demos and we'll be taking questions now. So any questions?
I see like the value of this is identified the bottlenecks on the rendering process of each one of the pages. But essentially, once you identify that, you didn't mention what kind of actions you should actually take in order to fix those performance issues or enhance the performance overall. So in this case, what would be the recommendations in general to provide these enhancements to the performance?
So you're talking about enhancing the performance using this model, right?
Yeah, this information. We already have this set of data, and we know the bottleneck. We identify what it is, how we'll go and do
so I'll take an example in this case. I've already given you a color box example where I actually preload the data just to make sure that the user does not get that janky experience, does not wait for the website to respond. Same happens in JavaScript. So if you're having your CSS selector very lengthy and you're using IDs then classes, then obviously the classes will take more time. So you have to be a proper architecture, architecturally correct before you actually start building some application. So rendering process, just the rail model in the rendering process give you the guideline where you should follow, but not the proper ways to do it. So it totally depends upon you how you do it. If the CSS selector should be proper, the JavaScript logic should be minimal. you should always preload the data and always prioritize the background process at the idle time. These type of things you need to take care about.
For optimizing, one of the recommendation would be to use BEM selectors or BEM classes. I think we can make out more of the, like for animation, we should prefer CSS animations over JS animations, which are basically if we do it via JS, we go through all the processes, JS.
And CSS transforms take less time. So there's one more thing called Flip, if you have ever encountered it, just Google it. So what Flip does it, so Flip is first, last, invert in place. So it uses CSS transform and it actually reduces your rendering process time and actually enhances your animation model. So you should look out for it on Google.
Flip so basically model. What Flip says is for any animation to do, it first, last, invert and play. Like you create your that first frame and visualize your last frame and even create it in the through JavaScript, and then what you do is just invert it like
so you actually reach to the last frame and you invert the CSS and you play the animation so that it gets back to the first frame, but actually it will looks like to the user that it has actually moved from first to last, not from last to first. So you have to search for it.
It says this because we know that if we transition from here to increasing that, so browser will have to calculate each and every pixels and then render it. But if we know exactly ki this is the our first frame and this is our last frame, and we even tell our browser inform that ki this is the end calculations, and then we animate it from this point to that point through CSS, not through JavaScript ki doing 1, 1, 1, 1, and so that would be more smooth animation, and that would be even into that 60 frame per second animation.
In fact, I should suggest you should do Google, because you'll find a proper blogs stating the proper theory and practicals, so that you'll get a proper idea.
Yeah, basically because there are endless recommendations for doing stuff. So for particular activity, there is a way, and in that way is good for a particular scenario, but that won't be that good for a particular the other scenario. So it all depends on the context of that. So you should
use CSS animations like CSS transform, CSS animation property, then using JavaScript. That's my key suggestion to you. Any other questions? No questions?
Is there any way to maybe slow motion action?
So for
is there any tool that gives me frame by frame action in a slow motion? Like what we see in the Selenium. Is there anything?
So there's no tool built, I think, yet. But you can always see it in the DevTools.
In Chrome DevTools, we have we can inspect each frame. So
you can see it always see it in a DevTool. There is no application built for it so that you can actually create an animation for frame to frame. But you can always see it in the Chrome DevTools. So this part of the technology we still have not gone forward through. There's no application that is related to. I think if you find on Google, you can find those plugins where you can use that thing, and I think you'll find a plugin that will do more or less the same you're talking about.
So if we have time, I'll just show it that flip effect, the difference between if we do a particular animation from JS and if we try to do it using flip. So see, for example, if we animate it. This gives me a very 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 janky. You can see the
end that is happening is not smooth. You can
actually see the frames moving, you know, in a janky manner.
And if we isolate it.
And now you see the difference. So this is the difference between JavaScript animations and CSS animations.
And even about that CSS properties, I'll show you one more thing. Like say in this timeline, so if we record this and we try to do scrolling, we see that our frame per seconds, the duration is
34 milliseconds, which is quite, it's two times of 16 milliseconds, what it should be.
FPS is around 29 FPS. But if we do a small modification here, in here, like if we go to our elements tab and then so if you go to CSS triggers, it says that this box shadow property is a very expensive.
So it takes too much time for browser to actually do implement the box shadow property.
So what I did is I just removed this box shadow property, and I'll try to run this timeline again. Do some scrolling, and then we check in here. So if you see that, the frames, it remains same.
So if you see that it's just reduced to through 2 to 3 milliseconds. So if you change just a single property, you can have that much of a difference. So it should be simple and clean. You should not use many CSS properties just to have a good user experience.
So basically, it improves very little, but yeah, it does make some impact over that.
So you should go with a simple and clean approach, not an hi-fi, because you are actually planning to have a good user experience, but the user will feel a janky experience and eventually gives a bad experience of your application. So you should try to make it simple and clean.
So then again, the recommendation would be not to use background box shadow, and you could use some alternative if it is being done for these many blocks. You can see. So the number of blocks here are too much. So that's why a single CSS property is affecting the complete. So when the paint activity will happen, it will happen for each of the blocks. And then it will compile to a big amount, 0.1 millisecond for a painting activity, where it used to take around 0.09 or 0.06 milliseconds. And you are now saying it brings about 1 millisecond difference. So again, so this is a big impact.
Any other questions? No, we are done with it. People are getting annoyed. You have to attend other sessions. Thank you for being so patient and listening to us. So we have these free giveaway stickers. You can always come here and grab those if you want to. Thank you guys. Thank you very much.